Hello students, in this course we look at digital forensic tools. Okay, so the agenda for this session is we'll look at tasks that are performed using forensic tools. We look at classification of forensic tool. So I've introduced a checkpoint, which is like a check where you can answer questions and then proceed. We look at a few tool sets, which is number one is SANSIFT, ProDiscoverer, Volatility. Then there's a checkpoint, all right, like a question answer session. Then second tool set is Autopsy, FTK Imager, and Linux DD, all right, these are commands. Third tool set comprises of Kane, Oxygen Forensic Detective. Then you got tool set 4, Hex Editor, Bulk Edit Extractor. All right, then I've also added a few use cases. So there are 4 use cases. The first one involves analysis of a JPEG file. Second involves analysis of a PDF file. Third involves analyzing a Word document. All right, and then in fourth, we'll try to grab passwords from memory. All right, using these forensic tools. Okay. So now, what are the tasks that we can accomplish using forensic tools? All right. Now, over the past a few years, right, digital crime has increased. This clearly indicates the criminals and hacking groups that are, you know, increasing. They're actually, you know, succeeding, right? The success rate is actually going up. Organized crime groups, you know, utilizing botnets are exploiting ACH fraud daily, right? We keep hearing so many attacks are happening on corporate networks, corporate environments, right? And similar groups also penetrate banks, merchants or e-commerce sites. They steal our credit card data, personal information, right? Fortune 500 companies also are beginning to detail a lot of data breaches and hacks in their annual reports or stockholder meetings, right? So that typically tells you the trend is that adversary or the attackers are getting better, they're getting bolder, and their success rate is again increasing, and it's impressive. So, but as cybercrime fighters or, you know, forensic people, investigators, are we able to keep up with them? So bottom line is not yet, but we can do better, right? So what we need to do is we need to develop a field of full of sophisticated incident responders, investigators, right? We need more lethal forensic investigation tools that can detect and eradicate all these advanced threats immediately. And proper people who are trained in incident responders and forensics experts can be the only defense for the organization during a compromise. So as a forensic investigator, right, you need to know what you're up against. You need to know what is the seasoned expert in that field, right? And then you need to stay ahead, constantly seeking new knowledge, experience, and that is what this forensics tool will tell you. All right, so typically the way it happens is at any crime scene, you have identification, you collect data, you preserve it. Then in your lab, once you go back to your lab, right, there you examine, analyze and present. So that is where the role of tools comes in, all right, in the labs. Okay. Now, how do we classify forensic tool? Like computer, these forensic tools are classified into categories. And some of them are mentioned below, and depending on the investigation required, these tools are utilized. Okay, so first is data disk and data capture tools, file viewers, analysis viewer tools, registry analyzers, internet analyzer, email analysis, mobile device analysis, right, operating system analyzers, network forensic tools, okay, and database forensics. So if you look at the whole list of tools, right, so it's a huge list where you can classify, pick up tools as per your requirement, as per the scenario, you can start doing investigations. All right, so let's look at a checkpoint here. Okay, so this is a question for you, right? Data that provides a roadmap or other information about other data is called, okay, block data, image data, custody data, or metadata, right? So information about data, right? So data about data is actually called as metadata, all right? So that is what the investigators, they look out for. Question two is this branch of forensic science having to do with recovery and analysis of digital evidence, all right, is digital forensics, CSI, private investigation, or computer fraud, right? So digital forensics deals with digital evidence. Question three, what action can be taken to make data difficult to recover from a hard disk, right? So I'm an attacker. I know my hard disk will be investigated. Somebody will look at my hard disk and then take out all my data. So what action should I be taking, right? As a malicious action, right? I can place all my documents in my recycle bin, unplug power, okay? Or I can format my drive, write zeros and ones, or I can format and initialize my disk. So the best option is you format your disk and write all zeros and ones, okay? Let's look at SANSIFT. Right, that's tool number one that I have on my list. So SIFT is basically a toolkit, and it's SANS Investigative Forensic Toolkit, SIFT. All right, so it's basically a Ubuntu based live CD drive or a CD that is released by SANS. Okay, and it's a distribution that has all the necessary tools on this Ubuntu operating system which are required to perform a detailed digital forensic and incident response or examination, right? So it is compatible with expert witnesses and includes all tools, all right? Raw dumps, forensic analysis format, picking up them, all right? Memory analysis, evidence format, all right? All in very in depth, all right? So the toolkit itself has the ability to examine these raw disks, multiple file systems, evidence format. It places strict guidelines on how evidence is examined, the read-only evidence, right? And then verifies that evidence has not changed, right? So that is the way it helps us, right? So the entire disk, the kit that is there on that CD, okay? It enables each investigator to accomplish proper and a secure examination of, say, drives, SATA drive, IED drive, or solid state drives, SSDs, right? And the toolkit consists of one tabu, okay, a write blocker, read only, IDE cable adapters, SATA adapters, FireWire, USB adapters, forensic tool adapters, all right? It also has SAN Windows 7 forensic analysis, a VM workstation. It's inbuilt inside it, inside the toolkit, and all these have a fully functional tools that are working with access of Data Forensic Toolkit or FTK, right? It also has all details that are required there, which can include timeline generation, right? SSD or MD5, the hashing tools, all right? It can also perform file carving, right? Using Scalpel or Foremost. Then there's Wireshark, which is a network forensic or a, you know, data gathering information where you can pick up network related packets. Then you got Vinito, which is ThumbsDB database examination tool. Then you got Pasco, which is IE, the Internet Explorer, web browser history examination tool. Then ReviewT, right, which looks at recycle bin, tries to recover or undelete all your deleted data. All right. Then you got Volatility Framework inbuilt, which does memory analysis. And in this course, we'll look at picking up passwords from the memory, okay, as a use case. Then you got DF Lab, PTK, which is a GUI front end for SleuthKit. All right. Again, SleuthKit is a tool. Then you got Autopsy. It's a GUI front end for SleuthKit again, okay. And then you got PyFlag, which is a disk and a log and examination tool. All right. So imagine so many tools inbuilt and ready for you to use for free for as part of that SIFT toolkit. All right. So the file system that it supports, I mean, you can imagine NTFS, ISOs, HFS, RAW, swap files, memory files, dumps. Okay, FAT 16, 32, 12, extension dumps, right? UFS, VMDKs, anything you can imagine, you'll find it there. And evidence emails that are supported are RAW, which is single file in a DD format, AFF, which is Advanced Forensic Format, AFD, AFF multiple files, AFM is AFF with external data, all right. Then raw splits, EWF, FUs, right, which is image splitting using a single raw file, you can split images, or split EWF, which is split E01 files, okay, and then mount them also. So imagine it's one of the best tools that anyone who is into forensics can think about. All right, then the second one is called as ProDiscoverer. Okay, ProDiscoverer is actually again a suite of products that caters to a wide range of scenarios, right, which are handled by cyber crime, cyber law investigators, corporate internal investigations. Okay, so this actually helps you find data on a computer disk, and it also protects evidence, and then it creates a evidentiary quality which can be used in legal proceedings when you create a case. So you have to present a case file to the legal guys or the legal department or maybe the HR department. So ProDiscover helps you create all that in very good quality report format. And this suite is actually equipped with diagnostics and evidence collection tool, depending on the corporate policy, compliance, investigation, or even for electronic discovery when you are creating a use case or a case against some employee. All right. So if you look at the diagram, so first part, it creates a read-only image of the evidence disk. So the main disk is not tampered. All the work is performed on the image, right? Then we add as a second step, we add disks directly to preview the evidence. We can also remotely capture multiple disks. We can also view hidden and deleted files. If there are hashes, then MD5 hash of files can be performed to verify integrity so that you know the original image and the modified image, if there's a difference between them, right? Then you can also identify illegal files if there are any lying there, right? Say imagine you got 10,000 files, right? So using ProDiscover, you can quickly identify them. ProDiscover is actually very flexible, and it has a very powerful full text search. So it indexes all the files, all the data that is seized there, and then presents you with a fantastic full text search. This works on Windows, Mac, and Linux file systems, and automatically all the evidence is generated in a very evident form and in a very quality report form, and it supports scripting also. For example, there are tasks that you want to do again and again, repetitive tasks, so you can easily do those. Now, some key features of this ProDiscover is you can preview and look at image disk. You can also preview and search suspect files so that you can find evidence very quickly without altering or making any changes to the data itself, or the original data or the metadata. This also automatically creates records, MD5, SHA-1, SHA-256 hashes of evidence file to prove any data integrity, right? It also creates bitstream copy of the entire suspect disk, including HPA section, or when you want to keep the original evidence safe, right? So it'll create a bitstream copies. And this also maintains a multi-tool compatibility by reading and writing images in the pervasive Unix .dd format. All right, so this is the format that is used by investigators. And then it can examine either all or any of the following file systems as listed below. Right, so Windows, FAT12, FAT16, FAT32, NTFS, all of them, right, including dynamic disks and software RAIDs. Then Mac operating system. So Mac X, you have HFS, HFS Plus, the new version that has come. So it can also examine that. Linux, EXT2, EXT3, or EXT4 even, right? So all versions of all types of file system that you can think of. Solaris, UFS also can be done. It is integrated with a graphics thumbnail viewer also. So where you can use it to view the files, what are they, and also view the registry, which is maintaining all your records. And this integrates with Outlook email, internet, and registry history viewer also. So the key features for forensic ProDiscoverer is it can extract clusters, files into logical file collections. And from these collections, you can also do a cross-reference for files, clusters. You can also import and export in .dd format images, right? For example, you have you collected some evidence. There's a file. There's a computer, right? You can create a image file of that, and then start working on it or investigating on that. You can also create and add evidences, comments. Okay, so for example, date, time, whatever you saw, which are of interest, you can add comments on that. And then it also has a disk wipe capability, right? It can also extract EXIF information from JPEG files to identify the file creators, their logins, their locations, when it was clicked, what tool was used, what mobile phone or camera was used, you know, what software was used, what was the version of that software. So all these details which are required for forensic investigation, report creation, you can also find out information about the JPEG file itself. Right, EXIF information is information about the JPEG files or the files, the image files. Then Linux boot disk provided along with this to image files and without removing the hard disk. So you can also use that. There's automated report generation which comes up in XML format, which saves time. It also improves a lot of accuracy and compatibility. So you can, you know, move this file or, you know, integrate this file in any software tool that you have. Then there's a GUI interface, right? Graphical user interface, and there's an integrated help function. So you can quickly start, use your mouse, and then quickly click and start working on it, which gives you an ease of use. All right. So, and it is designed to NIST disk imaging tool specification, which ensures again very high quality of work, right? And finally, it also supports VMware to, if you want to run any captured image, for example, you picked up a suspect's phone or a laptop and you created an image, so you can use ProDiscoverer. So there's a VMware, you can import that file, that image of the operating system or the mobile system, and then look at it. All right, now we come to volatility. It's one of the best open source application softwares that can be used for analyzing computer RAM or computer memory in 32-bit and 64-bit operating systems. It supports Linux, it supports Windows, it supports Mac and Android, the mobile phones that we have now. Okay, and it's primarily based on Python. Okay, but it can be run on Windows, Linux and Mac systems. You just need to have Python installed in it as an application, and then you can simply run this file, okay, run the application. Now what do you do after running it? You can extract information about whatever processes that are running, okay, in the memory. You can also look at open sockets, network connections, whatever dynamic linking libraries or DLLs were loaded for each of those processes that were called, okay, what are the cached registry hives that are there, what are the process IDs, and a lot more. Okay, so when you run it, you get image information -f menu dump dot raw. When you say dot raw, then it creates a memory dump of that file. All right, so whatever is information is there in your RAM, all right, so that gets saved as a dot raw file. So volatility actually helps you analyze the raw dumps or the crash dumps that we have, or even the VMware dumps, which is dot vmem or virtual box dumps. Okay, apart from the RAM dump, so it can be used for incident response, malware analysis, to extract any digital artifacts from the volatile memory dumps. All right, so you just need to run the standalone command line, right, .exe file profile and with raw.raw dump, and then you can have these DMP files created, all right, which can be analyzed very easily. Okay, so let's look at checkpoint 2. All right, so you need to organize so there's a list. You need to organize in the correct order for based on the most volatile to the least volatile. All right, so hard disk, RAM, archived data or media, paging file, logs stored on a remote system, and cache. Right, which is the least volatile, which is the most volatile? Right, so cache memory, which is the information on your RAM, right, cached and RAM, that is the most volatile. Then you got paging file, where a lot of data is transferred to and fro when you are working, browsing, deleting files, copying files. Okay, hard disk, again, where you store
the logs that are stored on remote system, and finally archived media, which is like a backup stored somewhere and kept away from the say in the IT room. Question 5 is, what is the main purpose of a volatility framework? All right, it can analyze disks, hard disk, it can acquire memory data for forensics, it can provide test data for analysis, or it can analyze memory data acquired from other tools. Okay, so it doesn't do that from other tools, it acquires memory data for forensic purpose. Which of the following best defines computer forensics? Okay, so you want to protect your business and individuals providing services for such business from internet based risks or threats. You want to protect computer systems and information from harm, theft, unauthorized use, okay, breaches, right? Then you want state of being protected against unauthorized use for information, especially electronic data, or the measures of protecting information, electronic data. Or computer forensics is the use of digital evidence to solve a crime. All right, so yes, computer forensic solves digital, it uses, analyzes digital evidence, and then it helps you solve crime. Okay, so let's look at autopsy now. All right, so the image that you see there, right, so you'll see a lot of images, files, views, right, days, right, extracted information, all those, and within that you have some GUI stuff, which is, and then you have some basic stuff, which is raw stuff, right? So it is an open source digital kit. Again, it's a toolkit, right, that performs a very in-depth analysis of various file formats, and it's basically a GUI, graphical user interface, that sits on top of a Sleuthkit. Now Sleuthkit is a executable, right? So it provides you that graphical view. And it has a lot of inbuilt features, right? Some of them are like, it has a very simple Windows installation, easily installed. It can be automated. It has a very intuitive workflow, right? So there's a MD5 hash, hashing lookup. It can also index keyword searches. For example, you have a lot of data and you want to search something specific. You can use this to do a very specific keyword search. You can also, deleted file carving can be done, right? Any file that has been deleted, you want to carve out. And that can also be done using autopsy. XF file data extraction, right? So there's a JPEG image that you've received. For example, imagine a scenario where as an investigator, somebody comes up to you and says, I received a ransomware call, and then somebody sent me an email. Okay, so this is the number that he called me from, and this is the image it has, and this is the email, it has an image, right? So when you look at the image, you need to analyze it, and then you can figure out when it was clicked, where it was clicked, the geolocation, right, the physical location, what mobile or camera was used, which version was it, okay, whether it was Sony, whether it was Kodak, or what was it, what software was used, right? So all these things can be used to create a case. Okay, you can also perform a time analysis of all the events. For example, you see recent files, right? So day 1, day 2, day 3, day 4. You can have a time analysis of all the events. You can also perform standard Android database parsing. You can also perform extension of mismatch detection, image gallery, just for pictures and reviewing them. You can also do an email extraction for email messages. All right. And also you can also do some network-based collaborations, right? For example, you have all this stuff, you can collaborate and integrate it with another investigator who's using or working on the same case but on a different angle. All right, so these evidences that you collect from autopsy can all be integrated together. So when you look at autopsy, it is something like this. So Python, where you look at some memory that is there, right? Windows logon, so it's a legitimate Windows logon process that is running, and it is showing you the dlist or the process that is running, right? But when you look at another one, right, so that is a malicious program running from a non-standard path. All right, so that is how you can find out any information or anything that is running which is malicious. Okay, so autopsy helps you find out all those kind of things as well. Let's look at FTK Imager. Okay, so data preview, and it's an imaging tool which can be required to assess any electronic evidence, which can determine if further analysis is required. So files and folders which are stored on hard disks, network drives, or CD, DVDs, right? You can preview the content of forensic images or dumps using FTK. So FTK basically creates exact copies, the perfect copies, okay? And these are forensic images of the data that you want to investigate, and it doesn't make changes in the original evidence. So the original evidence actually remains the same. All right, so it's a GUI look and feel that you have, and using that you can easily figure out, you can quick, easily you can create forensic images for further analysis. Now this also creates a SHA-1 and a MD5 hashes of files, so you can keep these files with you, all right, and then send it to different departments or people to work with. For example, there's an expert on, say, password recovery. So you have a SAM file dump, you keep that, create a hash file, and then send it to them. If he is able to find out the password, then he sends back the same hash, and if they match, then it is a true match and the original file was not changed. Otherwise, if the hashes don't match, right, then there's something wrong, right? So that is where FTK Imager helps you figure out if anything was changed or not, if the original files changed. Then you can also review and recover files that were actually deleted from the recycle bin also, so provided the data blocks have not been written. So you can also recover all these files. You can mount the forensic image to view its content within Windows Explorer as well. All right, so in a very simple way, it helps you, it'll show you all the details. Now let's look at Windows DD. Okay, Windows DD is not actually an application, it is a set of commands, all right, and these by default are there on all Linux distributions that are available, like Fedora, Ubuntu, Kali Linux, you name them, it's there, right? It's just a simple command. This lets you copy and convert a file, okay, and it offers operands to specify what kind of formatting you want to implement, right? So it can be used for digital forensic tasks. Like forensically you want to wipe a drive, right? You want to zeroing out a drive and then create a very raw image of a drive. So DD can be used to do that, right? Or for example, you want to cat files, you want to add them, right? So you can see and append or find out what is there inside it, right? DD, this command, can also be used to skip some initial bytes when you are reading some input text, right? You don't want to read the whole text, you want to bypass and skip and then read only the required text, which is maybe at the end, right? So this can be done using the skip option, right? And this just requires a numerical value to be told to this DD command, and it does it, right? For example, if this value is n, then DD will skip n sized blocks at the start of the input and then show you only the required stuff. So it'll skip the, say, 4 bytes, right, of any input file when you should set up n equal to 4, and then it'll use 1, 2, 3, 4 and then ensure it to skip it, and then while you're reading the input file. All right, for example, DD, if file 1 of file and IBS equal to 4, then skip 1. So 3 records in, 1 out, and then it'll show you only that required last block, the 4th block. All right. DD can also be used to swap pair of input bytes for, and this can be achieved by using swab, SWAB, as the value for converting commands on the line option, right? So you can use DD if file 1 of file 2 and conv equal to swab. So it'll do a input output on those and then change them. Okay, so that is where this command, it's a free command, it's just sitting there to be used. Let's look at Kane now, C-A-I-N-E. Okay, now this offers a complete forensic environment to integrate all software tools, modules, and it also provides a very interoperable environment that supports the digital investigator during 4 phases of the digital investigation, right? All the 4 phases. and it has some user friendly centralization tools. It can integrate with a lot of other tools, for example ticketing system or a database or, you know, all these things, report system, and then it also has a very friendly GUI in the graphical interface. It can also do report compilation. For example, there are 10 people working on a case, one of them creates a report, all right, that report can be input into this Kane system and it will be visible to all 9 people. This allows cloning as well, and by default it is available on most Linux operating systems, and this helps forensic investigators to preserve and collect and also examine and then analyze all the digital evidence that are involved in a cybercrime within a team. Okay, so for example, I have opened up Kane on a system, so I can use scripts, admin, file analysis, file info. I can also find files, I can do internet history analysis, all right. I can also open them as a root or, you know, copy them, these files, all right. And within Kane, there are a lot of tools that are available there, right. Arsenal image mounter is there, FTK imager is there, a hex editor is there, JPEG view, network related tools, Nearsoft is there, Notepad++ is there, which is where you can quickly type and keep some notes, right. PhotoRec, quick hash, timelines, making timelines. So for example, you're working for a case and it is stretching to 15 days, 20 days. You can quickly make a timeline. Okay. It also has a USB write protector and a Windows file analyzer. All right. So the next tool we look at is Oxygen Forensic Detective. Okay. OFD. So this is a all-in-one forensic platform, which is built to extract, decode, analyze data from multiple sources, all right, and these can include mobile, IoT devices, some backups, media cards, drone, okay, or even cloud services. And so you can find and extract vast range of artifacts, right, proofs, system files, credentials, from various type of operating systems like Windows, Macintosh, Linux, all right. And then you can relate them in a very GUI, very simple manner, right? From where, which, how is it collaborating, how many times it is collaborating, right? So all these things can be easily extracted from multiple sources and analyzed in a GUI manner. That is where Oxygen Forensics tool, detective, is very useful. Now this provides the investigators access to SMS, MMS or emails or iMessages with attachments, right, and of application chats that are going on. You can also use export buttons that allow can be sent to, you know, either one or selected message with attachments, and then report directly from this section itself. You don't need to have another, you know, reporting system somewhere else. You can push and export all those evidences to that report system. This can also bypass screen locks, for example, and locate passwords in encrypted backups. Right, it has that ability. It can also extract and parse data from secure applications and also uncover deleted data. Right, so it undeletes a lot of stuff. This also has multiple extractions that can be investigated in a single interface or the front end to gain a complete picture of the data. All right, so when you look at it, you can see WhatsApp messages, you know, video messages, Viber messages, SMS, all stuff. Right. Can pick and choose, right click and export them to a report, which is the relevant evidence, and then have your report ready, right. So this integrates with industry leading analytical tools also to find social connections, you know, you can build timelines. This also categorizes images, law enforcement, corporate investigators and other personnel to help them make this world safer and easily and faster also. So and it's distributed as a USB dongle, okay, and it's valid for a single user. So if you see this image, so this is iPhone, and it's showing you all the locations where this iPhone, was traveling, where it was going, right? In a very GUI manner. So even a simple, cyber crime guy who's a non-technical guy maybe, right? From a police, from a cyber cell, even he can understand. So this also consists of a lot of widgets, which are attachments or plugins, and these are divided onto two categories,
data on the device and the investigator interaction, right? So data on the device is displayed in the first widget and shows data present within the extraction in the chart or the tables, right? It will be like chart activity, chart metrics, last contacted information, data types, top 10 applications, contacts or groups, all right? The second group or the investigator widget displays the investigator's interactions with that evidence, right? Assigning some tags, marking data as key evidence with red, blue, green colors, adding and editing some notes, running some hash set files. So you have both ways, right? The evidence data as well as the investigator's information, all right? And it'll tell you in a very simple way, in a chart way, activity, metrics, right? All files in very colorful manner, right? Which anyone can understand. Now let's look at Hex Editor. Okay, so Hex Editor basically analyzes and edits binary files on any operating system as well as raw disk editing, and it also helps you modify the main memory or the RAM memory. Alright, and this displays the binary and hexadecimal data as grid cells with editable hex codes. Alright, so then it has the ability to process and interpret several terabytes of data in different formats very quickly. So terabytes is like huge data, and it can be quickly interpreted and processed. So it comes something like this. So you have a code where you want to search for specific stuff. So hex code or the hex editor allows you to inspect any underlying, even at a byte level or a bit level, and it's very useful for finding any unwanted characters which are there in your data. Alright, so it will show you the hard disk, the raw disk, and then the checksum. What exactly is it? Is it SHA-1 or SHA-MD5? Alright. Then it's a very deep level investigation editor, right? Used by several forensic people for deep analysis. Next, we come to bulk edit extractor, right? Now this extract email addresses, credit cards, URLs, and other type of information from digital evidence files which we are looking at. Okay, for example, you have a dump of data which has email addresses, URLs, all junk files as well, right? Noise, as we call it. Now it's a tool for many tasks, for performing such tasks like malware or intrusion detection, for example. And you have to investigate it, so you identify all these investigations, cyber investigation, and then analyze the imagery, and the it can also do password cracking as well, right? So it operates on disk images, files, or a directory of files, right? It extracts a lot of useful information without actually parsing the file system or the structures themselves, so it doesn't touch them, all right? And it's a command line this thing, and it quickly finds out and gives you all the dump. So from an image file, right, you can pick and choose and then find out exact specific file that you need. For example, there's a dump and you want to just find out Facebook related information, or say only Word related information, right? So this bulk extractor will just look at those, or maybe credit card information, right? So when you input all that dump, it'll take out only that required relevant stuff. So how does it do it is the input is split into pages. Okay, and it is processed by one or more scanners. Alright, the results are again stored in feature files that can be easily inspected, parsed, or even processed with other tools also. It so integrates with a lot of automated tools as well, and it creates a histogram of features that it finds. Alright, and this becomes useful because such features like email addresses, internet search, these are more common, and they are very important in our investigations. Alright. So when you look at this as an example, so we did a bulk extractor, we ran the bulk extractor, the report is ready, and it is showing all email IDs of people where this guy Matt, okay, there's a folder, and I'm assuming it's a name, and it was extracted. Okay. Let's look at some use cases now. All right. So use case one. This is analyzing a JPEG file. JPEG file is a photo file or an image file. So JPEG is a common method to compress photographic images using compression algorithms.
Okay, so that is why you use JPEG. Now this algorithm or the compression technique that is used, it minimizes the size of the image without actually impacting on the quality. Right? So when you analyze the file, the first field or the first sample you get is JPEG start, then you have motion, markers, reserved, motion, fields, okay, all that. So this is the structure that is there in a file. And using a free hex editor, right, you can actually find out the hex view or whatever is there on the file, and then you can analyze it. All right. Let's look at use case number two. Okay, a PDF file, right? A lot of you would be using PDF Acrobat Reader Writer, right? So all the format that is used is PDF file. So PDF and office documents, right? They can be embedded with macros. Right? Macros are small codes. These are written in Visual Basic Analysis Code, a language, and they were initially designed to execute multiple tasks, repetitive tasks. But hackers, when they started to come into being, they started executing malicious activities. All right, so they embedded macros, and these macros, whenever you open a file, it would execute. All right, and then maybe pick up your data, you know, download some exploit or some malware onto your machine. You know, all these commands, simple commands, can be embedded inside a macro. Right, so the PDF structure is actually, there's the header is there on the first line, which tells you the version of the file. Like it will be percentage PDF-10 to 1.3. Then you have the body, which is content. So it would have images, fonts, form field, text, bookmarks. Then the third part is a cross-reference table, which links all the objects in the file and allows you to access random objects and trace, update, search, any changes. Then you have a trailer, okay, which links the X reference, the reference table, and the main object, and this ends with percentage end of file, right? So when you end the PDF file, you have this EOF. All right, so again, a hex editor, when you open a PDF, it would show something like this. All right, so when you see percentage PDF dash some version, that would be the PDF version, body, cross reference tables, and then you obviously have the trailer. Use case three, we analyze Word and Word file, Word document, right? So Word document is again binary files. The structure is simple. You have a main stream which has binary data at header, which is offset at zero. It has then it has information about the document, the length and the pointers. It has a summary information streams, which stores summary and document information. Then the table stream, which actually contains data, reference, stores various Plex characters, positions, tables, which actually define the whole structure, the document structure. And then you have a data stream that contains the data that is referenced. And finally, you have the object stream, which actually holds the binary data for the embedded, maybe OLE objects or macros, which are inside the docx file. So when you look at the doc format, right, so you will see something like this. All right. So mainstream, pointers, summary, table stream, data stream, and then object stream. Finally, let's look at case number four, right? So this is a small experiment where we'll try and grab passwords from memory, okay? So the objective is somebody is using a system, right? And he's logged in, right? And his password and everything is in the RAM. So the object is, let's see if we can grab this. So we are using a standalone version of Volatility, and it's Windows operating system, right? So I install Volatility on the operating system. The idea is to attempt to gather some information from the memory dump. All right, let's see if we can gather some passwords. So for this, we open up a command prompt, right? We go to C prompt, we run this command, Volatility image info minus F, and then a name of that raw memory dump file name, right? You can do also the date at the end, right? Dot raw, right? So this is something like this you will see. All right, now I'm using a Windows 7 service pack 1. It's an old machine, all right, but you can use any machine for this, and works majorly on old machines. Most of the new operating systems are usually patched. As a second step, Now this command gives me a lot of pieces of information, right? For now we just need to know the profile, right, of the type of memory dump. So in a case we are using Windows 7 service pack 1 x86 machine, all right? So we just need to know the hive list so that we can get to the starting position in the memory where these registry information resides. Okay, so we run the command volatility hive list minus f, the same raw memory dump file, minus profile, and then win7 sp1 x86. Okay, simple, nothing fancy about it. We're just running a simple one single line command. Okay, so when we run this command, then you will see a lot of stuff being generated on your screen. It'll tell you the framework version, it'll tell you the virtual and the physical memory listings, it'll also give you name, the registry system, hardware, you know, where the DAT file is, where it starts, where the SAM is, security default, all stuff, right? So you get the virtual memory's location and then the physical memory location, all right? Now we know where the keyless items are located in the memory dump, right? We have that screenshot. So we need to extract password hashes from the memory dump. So we just need to know where the SAM file and the system file's keys are located. So when you look at the dump, you copy down the numbers from the first column that are corresponding to the SAM and system file locations, right? And then output the password hashes into a text file, right? As a hash.txt, all right? So volatility hash dump, all right? And the memory raw file, profile, and the memory locations, two. And you are piping them to a hash text. Okay, something like this. So a text file will be created, right? Which should have all the, you know, memory dumps from a location. All right. So I am using ntuser.dat, and I'm trying to pick up some information from that. All right, from the SAM file. Now when we open the hash file, the dump file that we created, you will see a lot of hashes of the user passwords now. Okay, it'll be something like this: administrator, guest, Fred, test, whatever we created, right? Now remember, this is not it'll show you the hashes. Now hashes are the passwords themselves, right? So if you're using Windows XP and have passwords shorter than 14 characters, right, then you can run them through something like a cracker, like John the Ripper. Okay, it's an application that you can find it in Kali Linux, or it's a freely available tool. All right, or you can also copy this long character string that you see there, 500 something something, all these things, AAD, all these, right? Okay, starting with 1000 or 500, right? Now always remember, those starting with 500, okay, are administrator admin logins. And those starting with 1000 or 1001, 1002 are users, right? So always target the 500 numbers. And then if you paste them in object security online XP hashing program, this usually cracks most passwords in around 5 seconds or maybe less, right? If your hash is good, all right? But this actually tells you that all the passwords are not really as safe as, you know, people think that, okay, I gave a long password and, you know, it's saved somewhere in Windows NT SAM file, and that SAM file is encrypted. But it takes very few seconds. If I have a SAM dump, I can easily quickly find out what is going on and then recover those passwords. So it is always useful to have dual or multiple authentication systems to secure your machines. All right, so thank you so much. This ends the course.